2,000 years ago. In Jesus' time, they were literal outcasts, separated from people they loved, forced to leave their jobs, their communities, and live in colonies. People with leprosy were despised, as they were hard to look at, scaly skin, open sores. As the disease progressed, ulcerations, loss of fingers and toes, skin swelling, facial scars. Lepers could have oozing sores and were a real danger of infection to other people. They were banished to live in colonies, alone and in pain, with other outcasts. Jews and Samaritans, normally enemies, forced together in the isolation of their illness. Leprosy was a condition to be feared, and high priests set them apart like contaminated goods. Some believed that God had punished them with the curse of leprosy for sins they had committed. And God gave the Israelites specific instructions on how to deal with leprosy in order to control the spread of the disease. There were cleanliness laws and purity laws in the book of Leviticus. Anyone suspected of having leprosy had to go to a high priest for an examination. If found infected, the leper had to wear torn clothes. His hair had to be over his face to his upper lip. He had to cry out, "Unclean, unclean." He had to live alone. He was considered unclean spiritually and physically, and banished from society. Leper colonies were large. There may have been more than 10 lepers on the side of the road when Jesus came by. How did the 10 lepers decide to call on Jesus? How did they have the hope to do that? Jesus, as healer, held a glimmer of hope for their desperate circumstances. We heard the story, keeping their distance, they called out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Noting Jesus as Master Healer, they asked for his pity and his compassion. Jesus responded, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." So they listened to Jesus, they trusted him, they did what he said, and on the way to the high priest, they were healed. They were made clean. Only one leper pauses. He thinks about giving thanks to Jesus. When he went back to Jesus, he praised God with a loud voice. He kneeled at his feet and thanked him. He was a Samaritan, a foreigner, not part of the Jewish circle. And Jesus asks his disciples a rhetorical question. "Are the 10 made clean? Where are the rest?" Jesus used this as a teaching moment to ask why. Why are the others not grateful? I wish this parable had a different ending. I wish all 10 were celebrating and thanking God for this new life they've been given. But as you know, our human condition blocks our actions. We are busy, we are on to the next task, we could make these relationships better than we lost. It reminds me of giving a gift and you don't hear back from the person. I wonder, did they get the gift? Did they like the gift? Why haven't I heard from them? So as a gift giver, I am uncertain as to what happened. And I think this is where Jesus is when only the Samaritan returns. Sometimes I'm guilty of missing a gratitude moment. I don't respond to all gifts that I get. Maybe I'm moving too fast or I'm on to the next thing. No time to pause. In this case, no time to thank God or praise God. If this happens when we get caught up in our own needs, we miss the best part of the gift. The gift of healing for the 10 lepers led to a second chance on life. Their whole lives were restored. They didn't have to live in the colony anymore. But 9 missed out. that second blessing from Jesus. He blessed their faith. But don't despair. Jesus is persistent. He will continue. I know that he probably continued with those non-lepers, and he graced them at another time because they were touched by Jesus, healed by him. Jesus blessed the Samaritan in his faith and sent him on his way. How often are we blessed and sent on? The next thing we need to do. When I turn back and think about it, a lot of times in my day, things get better. I try to appreciate the little things. The parking spot, the person at the coffee counter, sunbeams or colored leaves. These gratitude moments can balance out my frustration. And I find if I keep the phrase, "I am so blessed," in my mind, I'm ready to offer a short thank you to God when these gratitude moments happen. I heard a radio story about a person in Louisiana, and I was suspect. I thought to myself as I was getting ready for the sermon, did I really hear that story? Did that really happen? Well, the next day it was in the newspaper. So a man jumped off the boat as he saw a car going off the road into a creek. He dove down into the water, opened the car door, and rescued the woman out of her car. When they surfaced from the creek, she gasped for air and she said, "Get my dog, he's still down there." So the man dove back in and saved her dog. What a blessing this woman received. Her life was saved. She asked for more, saved Sassy, her poodle. I think this is how we can be with God. Before we even take a breath and say thanks for our lives, we're asking for something else. Now, after last weekend here at St. Luke's, with that wonderful blessing of animals, I understand. I would be asking for my dog too. But I encourage you to pause and give thanks. To stop and reflect on what just happened, or what you saw, or what you feel. The beauty of creation. Stop and appreciate it. And just send a quick thank you arrow to God. Our Eucharist prayer every week, we get this chance to live into gratitude. God gives us a place to say thank you for the times we may have missed during the week. So God's abundance abounds in this Eucharistic prayer that we'll hear. And we'll hear thanks 10 times in that prayer today. And it's called the Great Thanksgiving. So listen in. See if you can maybe count five. My favorite part of prayer is the beginning. It starts with, "Let us give thanks to the Lord our God." And we respond, "It is right to give God thanks and praise." And then Father Tim says, "It is a good and joyful thing to give thanks to you, Father Creator." So we hear the gift of God's generosity in this prayer. And we are given this chance of healing at the table each week. Last day, we pray who we are, and we're invited to offer thanks for this blessing of our lives through the Eucharist. So the blessing we get when we give thanks is more than we can ask for or imagine. Jesus said, "Your faith has made you well." Other lepers were physically healed, but the Samaritan was eternally healed. His relationship is brought to a new level with Jesus. Forever changed by this faith experience when Jesus sends him on and says, "Your faith has made you well." God blesses him forever, not just to heal him for this one time, but faith to carry him forward on the journey. Everlasting, an everlasting gift of faith, never to be lost. So in knowing this faith, he has a new relationship with God. He will never be alone in his trials. His physical health is renewed, and his spiritual life changed. This happens to us when we are graced by God. God provides all we have. Healings of heart and mind, body, material goods, our friends, our church, our family. Often, I can be independent, and I think, I have worked so hard, I deserve what I have from God. This great job is great because I'm good at it. I forget that I am nothing without God. I need to pause and remember God's abundance. So in closing, I'd like to read you a poem from a Christian pilgrim who, like the Samaritan, felt his heart change. Life does not hurry on through receiving.